Good morning, everyone. This is Jesus Name Ministries, and I just wanted to come to you this morning. Thank you for taking your time to listen and join us in this ministry today. I'd like to go to the Lord in prayer this morning and just ask Him to touch, amen, the lips and the hearts, amen, of my mouth to move on me as His servant and speak to you the truth. Amen. Happy New Year to everyone. And thank you, Lord, for this day. God, thank you, Lord, for many to come if you should so tarry. And God, let us keep in mind, God, your soon coming, Lord. And those, God, that need to hear your voice, God, and need to hear and feel your spirit, God. And I just pray, God, today that your word, God, would not return void, God, that you would move mightily, God, on all the listeners, God. Amen. And even in my heart, God, today, Lord, open our eyes, God. Refresh our hearts. And God, that love that you give us, Lord, and we just praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Again, thank you and Happy New Year. We're going to be talking, I feel this could be one of, if not the most important message that the Lord has given me to date. I say that in all humility. I say that in all truth and sincerity. And what I'm talking about and what the Lord has put on my heart is that bringing it all back to Jesus. Bringing it back to Jesus, amen. Do you identify with Christ? Or are you just somebody that shows up? You know, we've all had friends, we've hung out, and you know, many of us just kind of hung out in the neighborhoods or whatever. Maybe that's not done so much today. My kids still do it, mainly in our yard, but just being hanging out with someone. And I know we've got this thing that people say, oh, you know, guilty by association. It goes only so far. That doesn't mean that's what I believe. And you know, there's arguments both ways in that. But getting right down to it, what's in your heart? Amen. Why are you in the midst of a certain place or around a certain people? Amen. Many are on the fence. Many come to observe. Many are not there to participate, but rather to observe because they find it amusing. If not amusing, they may be interested in doing it themselves or at the decision point. And I don't want to go too far off of this, but what I am talking about today is the accountability and identifying with Christ, right? So a week or so ago, I'd laid out the account of Jesus, the Gospels, and you know, the letters, the epistles of the apostles and other writers that have, you know, placed for us what is called the New Testament, writings of the new church, amen, the new covenant of Jesus Christ. So when you look at that, many are mere spectators. They go to church to spectate. They're just enamored by what they see, what they feel, what they hear. The music, in some cases, is about the only reason some go. They like the praise and the worship. Amen. So they like the get-togethers, and it's a very hard thing to break off of if you have been accustomed to. And we are creatures of wanting to be around someone. God put that longing in us to communicate and to be a part. Now, we don't care if anyone's around. That's okay with us. And it seems to be, at least what I see and hear on the social media, many feel that way today. And I don't go too far into all this here, but I want to get into the word. You know, 2 Second Timothy 2:15 actually talks about approved unto God, study to show thyself. Amen. Approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And with this account of Jesus, and again, I'll just show you what we had last week. Amen. You want to choose Jesus in the Gospels? If you do, then everything else has to be based and judged from that. And, you know, if there's differing opinions or writings or anything by anybody, including the apostles, amen, then we must go back to the gold standard of Jesus Christ. Now, everything is based, even the letters are based off of the Gospels of Jesus Christ. If they're not, then Jesus doesn't exist. So that's where we're at today. That's where we're at when we rightly divide the word of truth. Study to show yourself. Now, what many limit this to, and the scope that they narrow it to, is that the Bible is all, everything is exact truth, and that's the ultimate word, and that's by which we have to be judged. Now, I would say that is true in the words of Jesus. Outside of that, if it does not coincide in concert, match up with not only what Jesus said, because we sayings and words could be construed and moved out of what their real meaning is, but by the spirit in which Jesus said what he said. All right, so we have to be very careful. That's why it says, study to show thyself. Amen. Approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed. Amen. Rightly dividing the word of truth. So I just want you to know that we have got to, even the word of God is subject unto the spirit of Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost. And that's where we're going to put our emphasis today, because you do not have the spirit of God. The spirit of Christ, he is none of his. You understand that? That is true. Amen. Jesus in John 3:1-8 talked to Nicodemus, if you're not born of the water and of the spirit, if you have not made that conversion to leave and lose your life and give it to Jesus and follow him, then you are not his. If you love him, you will keep his commandments. Amen. Amen. And if Paul's writings differ from what Jesus said, and it is very clear, then you must not listen to Paul. You must not listen to Peter. Now, however, you must find a way to, not by constraint, not by twisting the scripture, but a favorable way of not only what Jesus said, but by the spirit which it was done. So when you look at that, when you hear, and I'm going to give you a straight up example here, there's going to be men, there's going to be teachers, preachers, pastors, whatever. They're going to try and wash this away. They're going to try and twist it up, and oh yeah, and they'll even character assassinate the person, the messenger, to prove, try to prove an invalid doctrine or teaching, right? So what happens when we see that one of the big things today is, oh, well, obey them that have the rule over you, and oh, the pastor is the under-shepherd, or he is the shepherd. In one case, one preacher told me, and he is the shepherd. He's in stead of Jesus. That's false. Amen. That's what the devil would want you to believe. All right, so there is no man between you and Christ, okay? If so be that you have received the spirit of the Holy Ghost, that is his spirit dwelling within you, that he said is the spirit of truth. Amen. So I want you to know, you have to identify with Christ. Man cannot, will not, never will, and if they could, Jesus wouldn't have had to come save you. give that back over to the priesthood. God did not come in flesh as a baby, grow up, suffer for us, and go to the tree with the sins of the world just to give it back to man. Man will propagate Jesus. And if that spirit is not lifting Jesus, then it is not the spirit of Jesus. It is not the Holy Ghost. He said, when the spirit is come, he will glorify me. That was Jesus's words. Okay. He will not glorify man in man. No flesh shall glory in God's presence. There is these titles, these things that man wants to put forth. I go back to have the rule over, obey them that have the rule over you. Well, if you go to Matthew, and I say this and you'll hear this a lot, Matthew 20, 25 and 26, read up and down, read the story. You'll see that Jesus has no favor. With God, there's no respect of persons. He is not going to give extra Holy Ghost to someone opposed to another. This is the same spirit that raised Jesus up. Amen. If it was good enough for Jesus, you don't need any more of it. You understand that? And he said, one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one in all. Amen. He said, ye are all brethren. Again, back to Matthew 20, 25, 26. Read it. Go to Luke 22, 25, 26. It's also harmonized in Mark. I don't say that because many say the writings of Matthew came from Mark. So maybe that was copied over. So I leave that out just for that. But by two immutable things, by two witnesses, two or three witnesses, let every word be established. That matches that. That crosses that bar. That is good. So when you come off with one scripture, the fivefold ministry, how it's to perfect the saints, and say they're a rule over you. The Holy Ghost is the rule over you. If you don't quiesce to the Holy Ghost and not man, God never put it back to the priesthood. But yet most, and if not almost all, organized religious churches, UPC, Jesus Name, all these Assemblies of God, all of these have a hierarchy in the church, which Jesus said is not going to be so among you. He wasn't just talking to the apostles. You can't make that. You cannot make that argument, period. There was not a two-tier system. Jesus had to start with somebody, pick 12, because that's the tribes of Israel. It meant something, still means something. But that's why he chose. Somebody has to propagate this. It was not an eternal thing for the salvation for here on earth. He did not come to build his kingdom here. If it was just for the apostles, they'd still be living today. But it wasn't. They was to propagate it on and on. So the specialness of them was to start of Jesus being able to witness him personally. And that is passed down to us in writings, amen. And that you will find. There is 12 apostles, amen. You will find that in Revelation. They are going to be on the gates, amen, on the pillars. 12 pillars with the name of the apostle on it. There's no more, okay? You have to validate these things, amen. So when you do that, you have to let people understand and teach them. Because it's not just reading something, it's not just telling someone something, but it's a validation process. And the greatest validation that we have of this gospel of Jesus Christ today is action. When I believed, he said I would receive the Holy Ghost. If I obey, he would do this. And when I did obey, when I did it like he said, I received the Holy Ghost. How did I know I received the Holy Ghost? The Bible said that they spoke in tongues like we did. That's how the apostles knew the Gentiles received the Holy Ghost. Amen. That's how I know I received the Holy Ghost, because I spoke in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave the utterance. I didn't go to stone thing for Babel to learn another language. I didn't use any of those apps. I didn't know any other language. I speak in another language many times, and it does. It's not just the same one. It's not a see my tie, tie my tie. That's not what it's all about. It's the Spirit of God gives the utterance. Amen. So when you look at that, and once again, get back to the fact, are you just hanging out? I'm just hanging out with Jesus. Well, let me tell you the difference here. You see, the apostles, you look at Peter and all the things he saw, he was chosen from God. Jesus handpicked Peter. But when the rubber hit the road, when Jesus was taken captive, amen, when Peter was, when they picked him out and said, hey, you're part of that Jesus guy. You're associated with him. And Peter said, oh, no, not me. Peter began to curse and try to even demonstrate that he wasn't. You hear Jesus cussing? Hey, maybe I'll cuss. The Bible said he cursed. Which is not good communication. So, you know, we should try to live holy life, right? We're not like the world. We're not of the world. We're not doing the things of the world. Amen. So the checkpoint here, the identity of Jesus means everything. Jesus constantly was talking about leading people to him. The Holy Ghost, when he's come, he will speak of me. He will glorify me. He will witness of me. Amen. So Jesus said in 1 Corinthians 3:11, no other foundation than that of Jesus is laid. Now you can go get in the weeds all you want. I'll pull this thing right back up. If you want to check no to Jesus, then you can go over to the epistles. And you can say, okay, well, Paul says this, or Peter said this, or hey, 2 Corinthians says this, and you know, you can go that route if you want. And if it ain't matching with what Jesus said, and by the Spirit, important, by the Spirit in which he taught, I'm warning you today, that will not last. You know, John had an identification problem too, because John at one point, when he was put in prison and heard of the things Jesus were doing, he said, is this he? Or do we look for another? Some of you don't even know if this is him. You don't know what you're hearing, that church is him. Matter of fact, if you're a Bible reader, you're seeing a lot of things that aren't him. You're hearing a lot of things that aren't Jesus. You've got two Bibles. You've got a Jesus. You've got the Gospels of Jesus. And then you've got the letters, the epistles, to what they call to the church. And these are not read correctly today. Jesus said to study to show thyself approved unto God. How do you study? Everything is on the table for reproof, for correction. Just like the Bible said it. For reproof, correction, you'll find that 2 Timothy 3:16. It's profitable for doctrine, for teaching, reproof, correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now, let me tell you something. That's not saying, and this is misread, that's not saying, oh, just everything that's in there is right. Excuse me. And I'm not saying that what's in Scripture is wrong or shouldn't be there. I'm just telling you how you're reading it and how you're absorbing it and how you're understanding it and how you're listening to others that are falsely teaching it, twisting it, is wrong. if it doesn't match Jesus and the spirit which Jesus said it and meant it, it is not profitable. It's not profitable for you to do it. Excuse me. It's not a commandment. It is all subject to the words, the Spirit of the Holy Ghost. Words of Jesus, the Spirit of the Holy Ghost. Now, I give you a plain example in the past message where how do I validate the Holy Ghost? How do I validate when Jesus said, Peter, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom, and whatever you bind here on earth, I'm going to bind in heaven. What you loose on earth is going to be loosed in heaven. Now, what is preached wrong is that Peter has this extensive or extended throughout the rest of his life authority on how to interpret what Jesus said. And whatever he did in the book of Acts is solid Jesus. It's not. You have to understand how you can use even the scripture to twist things. And man is doing it. So when you're looking at profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, even the word is subject to scrutiny by the Holy Ghost, by the words of Jesus. When I get to Acts, and I said this before, and I'm just going to quickly touch on it, Acts 15, read it. If you begin to at verse 15 and 1 and start reading there, you'll see that there's a sect of the Pharisees who are disciples and said, hey, you got to be circumcised. Okay, well, stop. I got to go get circumcised. Okay, now you continue reading, and then you find out you didn't need to be circumcised at all. But yet that was the disciples. They was with Jesus. They knew Jesus. So you got to understand rightly dividing the word of truth. You have to divide it. You have to know. God didn't just throw this out there so people that wanted to be critical could just use it and for evil. He made this in such a way that you are forced in understanding of it to be led by the Spirit. Second Thessalonians 2 and 10 talks about with all deceivableness and lying wonders, they will deceive you. What's it talking about? Man will deceive you. They're led away from Christ. They lead you away from Christ. And just here a little bit ago, I posted, and some of you may have already read it by now, but the fact is, approved under God is showing evidence of why one should believe something, not just to do it. Just reading a few of his writings to prove a larger point is not teaching Jesus. And that's what the predominant messages are today. When you go to church, you're hearing Jesus. You're hearing quotes here and there of Jesus. You're hearing quotes of Paul, Peter, Mark, Luke, John, Matthew. You're hearing James. So you're hearing quotes, and you think, oh, yeah, well, that's Bible. They're a good Bible church. They say scriptures. Well, that doesn't make them a good Bible church, because the devil used scriptures. Do you not know when Jesus was after 40 days, he was hungered, and the devil took him up, and he said, well, thou it says that if you dash your foot on a rock, so the angels will take care of you. Satan used the word of God. Is it any strange thing? The Bible says that the ministers come in sheep's clothing, wolves in sheep's clothing, that the ministering spirits could come as an angel of light. You've got to know this. Now, I'm not trying to complicate a whole lot of things. Some people are like, well, gee, what do I believe now? What do I believe? You know what you believe? You believe in what's validated by Jesus. That's what you believe. And again, we go to John 3. You know, everybody knows 3:16. You know, God so loved the world that he gave his only God. Let's back up. Let's go to the first of that same chapter. So if you believe that, why don't you believe this? He said, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he can't see the kingdom of God. And he said, he said, you can't enter the kingdom of God. And he said that when the Holy Ghost has come, he's talking in there. He said, so you'll hear a sound. The wind blows where it listeth. He said, you hear a sound thereof. And he said, so he's talking about the wind and the sound, right? And when you hear that, you look at that, he's giving you clues and hints. And he said, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. This will happen to you, born of the Spirit. You don't have to be born of the flesh again. Born of the flesh is just vain. It's not going to happen. So here we are. Jesus said this. And then you see where Jesus told Peter that upon this rock, upon the confession of who you think I am, which God gave you, the sacrifice, the Son of the living God, which taketh away the sins of the world, the Lamb of God. Okay. Upon this rock, upon this revelation, I will build my church. And we already know, he said, that which is flesh is of flesh, but I'm coming that you may have a renewal of spirit, that you could be born in the Spirit. So Jesus was all about the Spirit. So when you're talking about that, he's not talking about earthly churches. He's not talking about earthly rebirths. He's not talking about wealth here. He's talking about, he said, where your heart is, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Lay it up in the heaven, not on earth. Amen. So when he was talking to Peter, he told him that I'm going to use you, Peter, for my plan of salvation. And when that time is right, when the Spirit is come, he's going to tell you what to say. You're going to stand up boldly, and I'm going to back it up. All right? So when Jesus told them, go tarry, he said, I'm going to be here with you, but one day I'm going to be in you because I must go away. And when I return, I will send the Comforter. The Father will send the Comforter in my name. Amen. So when he has come, he will lead and guide you into all truth. Was it brother so-and-so? Was it pastor so-and-so? Was it Peter, your generation and your sons, and we're going to just follow it that way and they're going to have that key? No, Peter was going to be gone. What did he mean? He meant the Spirit. The Spirit of the Holy Ghost will be here forever. It does not have a termination time. It does not have a time to live here on earth and pass away and go to the grave. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of God, which will always be here for us. He would not push us back to the priesthood, to man who will die again, who is not worthy, by the way, to even guide you. It is the Holy Ghost that he talked about. That, my friend, is the gift of God. That is, it came through a babe in the manger. That was just the transport mechanism to get it to us. Amen. Amen. So, and to take death, amen, the sins of the world and take them to the cross and put them on there and kill them and put them in the grave, amen, to give us life more abundantly, amen. The importance of the inscription of the cross. Remember that, the INRI. We'll talk a little bit about that in another session, but that was Jesus of Nazareth, King of Jews, that inscription. Amen. They didn't want anything on there, but yet it was made mandatory. Amen. So it was put on there. It meant something. Amen. Excuse me. And when you look, when they were talking, Jesus said, which is easier, to forgive sins or to heal someone? He forgives sins. They said, it's blasphemy. You're making yourself God. And they went to stone him. And Jesus took off. Excuse me. And I want you to know that the law, Amen. Jesus was under the law. We have to understand that. He was under the law. He was taking the law to the grave. That law was about to be abolished. Romans 10 and 4 said Christ is the end of the law. Everything was building up to Christ, the Messiah. And afterwards would be only Christ. Amen. So all those things, the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. What does that mean? The Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost. You must have the Spirit of Christ or you're none of His. Amen. Very important. A name was important. Jesus, the Bible said, Acts 4 and 12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. Colossians, I think it's 3:17. So whatsoever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Whatsoever, everything, not anything left out. Amen. That's why you see the name being so important. You'll see Jesus of Nazareth. They want you to know exactly the Jesus because there was other Jesuses. People named Jesus there. Amen. The John Mark. Amen. There many times you'll see names in the Bible where they talk about, they'll even include their parents. Amen. To let you know which one it was, which James, which John. Amen. Names were important. Identification was very important, and we have to identify with Christ. If you don't identify with Christ, what does that mean? That means you have to have the same mission as Jesus Christ. So, if you're reading the ending of Matthew, you would see that after he's taken from the sepulcher, amen. The greetings of the angel of the Lord, they came to Mary and him, came to see about getting the stone moved so they could dress his body and things of this sort. They knew he was dead. They didn't come to find an alive Jesus. Amen. They didn't come for that. But the angel of the Lord said, hey, why seek ye the living among the dead? Jesus is risen. The stone was rolled away. Amen. Luke 24:17 talks about also where Jesus had joined two of them after he had returned. Amen. They were two of the apostles. Amen. We're walking and just talking about how the Lord was no longer with them. Everybody was distraught. It was just a wreck. All the hopes that Christ, our Messiah, has come. He's going to set up a kingdom. And this is what they thought. That now we're not going to be bound. We're not going to have to do all the things we have to do. All the struggles we have is all going to be taken care of because the Messiah has come. Amen. And Jesus, the Bible said, joins himself with the two of them in their walk. And Jesus asked them, said, what are you talking about? And who's this you're talking about? Because they were talking about Jesus being gone, and they're like, dude, what's wrong with you? Are you new to this area? I'm paraphrasing. Are you new to this area? Do you live around here? Everybody knows what's going on right now. Jesus died. Amen. And the Bible said that. And this is part of what I'm talking about, identifying with Jesus. He is not dead. His spirit is alive. And if you can't feel him, he said, feel after me, that happily you might find me. He is alive forevermore. Amen. He has conquered death, hell, and the grave. Amen. So anyhow, while he was walking with them, amen, he revealed himself and began to explain his identity. And the Bible said he started with the prophecy since Moses. And he began to show them that this was how he came about. And he was the one that it was talking about all through here. Amen. So when you get to that, you see that Jesus was telling about himself. It wasn't about Moses. He started at Moses and was talking about himself. This is me. And he opened, the Bible said, their understanding. And as he began to, they got to the place they were going to, and they started off the path. He kept walking. I said, hey, why don't you come eat with us for dinner? And you can go read the story yourself. I'm not going to go into all that. But the point is here, and the Bible said that they, after he sat down with them to eat, and then he vanished away while they were sitting there. And they both began to confer with one another and said, you know, I did feel something. When we was walking with him and we didn't know who he was, did not our hearts burn with desire? Wasn't there just something different? Amen. And so those things there, identification, they identified with that. Amen. And Jesus said, it's me, Jesus. When they were walking, he was walking on the water, and the ship was about to wreck and stuff. And Jesus, they were scared. And Jesus said, it's me, it's I. Be not afraid. Amen. He was the atonement. Amen. And again, we go back to Romans 10 and 4. Christ is the end of the law. He brought us to the end of the law. The end of the law means the end of the law. Amen. It is not enforced today for the Christian, for the New Covenant Church. It is Jesus. It is only Jesus. Amen. You're not serving Moses. You're not under the law. You're not doing tithes. You're not doing altars. Amen. Those things are done away with. Amen. You have no need for an altar. Jesus was the perfect sacrifice, that atonement. When you understand, when you have a relationship, a true relationship with Jesus, not some patty cake to Jesus. And I'm not trying to put down people that are going to church and feel like they're doing everything they can. They're giving money to the church and they feel like that's what they need to do. But I'm telling you, his way is more abundant in life. It is not constraint. If you're paying tithes today, you're doing it by constraint because guess what? It's the law. We're not under the law. How many times did Paul have to say that? How many times is those things that do are in concert with Jesus and the Spirit, why he said things? Those many things are through there in there. But I'm telling you, there's no fivefold ministry today in force. And I know that's gonna really upset a lot of people because that's all you've been taught. You have one Holy Ghost. What about the gifts of the Spirit? That is different than having the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is going to be the rocket fuel that's going to take you just like Jesus. That same Spirit that lifted Jesus up. His is going to bring you to all truth. Amen. It is the Spirit of truth. Amen. So if you have the Holy Ghost, you have all you need. As long as you are abiding by the words of Jesus Christ and you are being holy as he's holy. Amen. And you're not doing those 50 some things that he said that's not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Those things, and people talking about the old law, 10 commandments are still in effect. No, they're not. Not in those words. I don't have 10 commandments today in the covenant of Jesus. I have over 50, if you want to get technical. I can't be effeminate. I can't be abusers of mankind. Go read them. They're in the letters. They do correlate with what Jesus said. Because how do I say it? How do I connect that? I'll tell you how I connect it. Because Jesus said, oh, yeah, well, in the law, it said that you cannot have adultery. But I say, if you think on a woman, you've committed adultery. There's your link to Jesus. So now I know those things are true. So this is what I'm talking about. The Holy Ghost will guide you. He will solidify those things that are right, those things that are true. Amen. He is the Spirit of truth. Amen. Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. He is that I am. Amen. Praise God. And I want to get through some of my notes here. And they're not notes to just read verbatim, but just to keep me in line here with what the Lord gave me. And so anyhow, Jesus, what is Jesus today to you? Amen. He said he's the way, he's the truth, he's the life, he's the promise, he's the Messiah, he is the King of Jews, he was, is, and is to come, the Almighty, amen, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the Rose of Sharon, he's the Lily of the Valley, the Bright Morning Star, amen, he's the Alpha, Omega, we said that, beginning and the end, he's the Jehovah, not just Jireh, not just salvation, but he's Jehovah everything or he's nothing. That's the Bible. That's the Jesus I know. He's the water from the rock. Amen. He is the rock. Amen. He's the bread of life. Amen. He's the first, the last, the all power, the life, the wine, the new wine. Amen. He's the buckler. He's the shield. Amen. He's the water. Amen. To him that is athirst. Amen. Praise God. He's the fire. He's the air, the wind. Amen. The sacrifice. He's the redeemer. Amen. That's who Jesus is. And if he's not all those things to you, amen. If he's the pastor to you, then I'm sorry. You missed him. You missed him. He is not a pastor in man. Amen. He did not allow man to come between him and you. Amen. That is not his purpose. That's not why he died. He could have kept the whole priesthood under Moses. Why would he want your unknown name pastor? He had Moses. He could have kept Moses around. Now, I'm not getting into philosophies because I don't believe in the philosophies. If it ain't word, then it ain't. So again, I'm not saying everything in the Word of God is wrong. Some of it is just for instruction. Some of it is just for knowledge to understand the whole idea of who Jesus was, what men did. You'll find that all through even the 66 books of the Bible. You'll see a character of God. You'll see how he dealt with man. But when we get to the new covenant of Jesus Christ, and you'll see that the gospels and the telling and the Jesus talked about things to come. That's why most Israeli people don't feel he was anything more than a prophet. A lot of prophecy on the new covenant. He couldn't have that exercised until after his death. And guess who showed up after that? His spirit. In us. He said, I will be in you, not just with you. That's what he told the disciples as he was walking with them. There's coming a promise. Amen. Joel 2:28, Acts 2:38, where Peter stood up and said, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, that in the last days, amen, the new wine, amen, that was the first miracle Jesus did. And that man said, hey, most people put the good wine up front. But you've saved the best wine for last. Amen. And what did Joel say? In the last days, I will pour out of my spirit. Hey, wine, pouring. You understand, this stuff just doesn't happen. And Isaiah 28:11, with new tongues, with stammering lips and a new tongue will I speak to this people. Amen. They shall prophesy. Amen. These are all tie-ins to what I know salvation is. And I know it comes right back to Jesus authoring it. He authored it in John 3:1-8. That's where it began. That's where it started. That's where it is absolute. Peter didn't invent it. What Peter said on the day of Pentecost, when he gave Acts 2:38, he was overcome by the Holy Ghost. He quiesced to the Holy Ghost that Jesus, his spirit. That's who was talking. That's what Jesus said. Thou art Peter. Amen. Upon this rock, I will build my church. Upon this confession, upon this instruction, I'm going to build my church. He didn't say he's going to have a building on earth. Jesus never taught of buildings here. He taught of lay your treasures up in heaven, where moth nor dust nor rust doth corrupt. All these parables are talking about heaven, the Spirit. Amen. What did he tell the woman at the well? He said, the time comes and now is when the true worshipers will worship me in spirit and in truth. It's not going to be a place. It's not going to be at Jacob's well. It's not going to be in Jerusalem. That's where it started because that's where he said to tarry. But it's not there that we find Jesus. He's wherever we can reach out to him. He said, come boldly to the throne of grace. Amen. We don't need man. We don't need priest. All of us preach the gospel. What is the gospel? It's not telling everybody how to live. The Holy Ghost is the teacher. Now, the fact that men have been moved by the Holy Ghost and shared what they said, but you're taking it all wrong. You're reading the scripture all wrong. If Jesus wanted just a letter, he would have left things as they were. That's not what Jesus sent back. He could have sent back a golden book. We're not bound by the letter without the concert of the Holy Ghost confirming. That's where many people and the majority is wrong that are even in church today. The letter killeth. If you think you're going to go letter to letter and, oh, I've done this, look at the rich young lawyer. Or the ruler, right? Rich young ruler, where he said, oh, Lord, from my youth, I've done all this. He said, go sell everything you have. Give to the poor. Was money the object? No. He just knew that's what the man was unwilling to give up. Jesus didn't tell him, he wasn't trying to make him poor. He wasn't trying to, that wasn't the emphasis here. That wasn't the spirit Jesus was pushing through, because obviously he knew that he probably owed people. He still had to have money to live, things like that. He wasn't trying to make the man go starve to death. See, you have to understand the scripture. You have to understand how to apply it, how to understand it. And that is only going to come through God's spirit. The Holy Ghost. You can't do it any other way. That's why we can sit there and pick scripture here and there, and we can say, here's the Apostolic UPC, United Pentecostal Church International, here's the Name of Jesus Church, here's the Assemblies of God, here's the Methodist Church. That's how you get those religions. That's exactly what they are. They pull over the old law. They make it where it's benefactor to man. Amen. Look at the money. You feel like God wants you to have to own a building to pay all these things and be burdened and have to ask people for money? Was that Jesus? That's not Jesus. That's nothing to do with the Jesus that I read about. Nor you if you're reading the Bible. And I'm going to touch a little bit here on missions. People want to, I want to go here to this, and a brother wants to go there, and I feel the Lord. No, you're feeling the pressure of man trying to put another feather in their hat, saying, I sit, brother, so, this family's over doing a great work for God. Work for God? Are you kidding me? You telling me that God can't take the guy on the dirt road? I don't know. He did it to Paul. Did you not know that Paul said he was on the road to Damascus? He was killing Christians and all this stuff and committing them to prisons and everything else. And all of a sudden, Jesus showed up to him and said, hey, why persecutest thou me? And you know the story. And you're going to tell me Jesus is not powerful enough to do that today. He needs to disrupt your family where he had already put you for a purpose. And he wants you to pack up. He wants you to go beg for money from a bunch of people, get commitments, and send you to another country. He wants to upend your family because he wants to upend your family because he wants to teach you a lesson. God don't work that way. That's man's construct. That's organizational baloney, if you want to know the truth of how I feel about it. God don't need to disrupt your whole family. He's not trying to teach you a lesson. You have people where God puts you. Be content. Godliness with contentment is great gain. You're just not content. Don't listen to those false people. Don't listen to them. They don't even know the Jesus you're supposed to know. My Lord, I'll tell you, we have got to get a hold of this. We have got to get a hold of what God wants for us. It's simple, my friend. We propagate the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't run around, hey, you can't cut your hair, ladies. You got to wear dresses and all this stuff. You live what you feel God is convicted and what you see in the Word of God. That is your testimony. Holy Ghost, teach other people. You get them to Jesus. You get them to knowing that they can have the Holy Ghost and life more abundant, that river of living water. You let them know they can have the joy of the Lord. That's what we are commissioned to do, the gospel. Not the other thousands of words of oh, well, you got to be taught. You got to do this. You got to do that. You know what? The Holy Ghost teach you. Paul said it. Let some bells go off for once. Instead of listening to man's tradition and their garbage. And I'm telling you, in so many cases, that's exactly what it is. It's garbage. Paul said, doth not nature even teaches itself? Wow. What a concept, Paul. That's a good thing. But yet we think we got to get up and preach people to hell because they're not doing it the way we think we're supposed to be doing it. Not one time did Jesus say, oh, well, go down here to the priest. I say that's funny because some of you is going to say, oh, well, he said to go show yourself to the priest. Yeah, that was to get the certification to get back into society and to let them know what Jesus just did, so he gets glory. That's the two reasons they went to the priest. Not to be under them, not to come and say, oh, Lord, forgive me. No. They're another twisting scripture that these carnal-minded people who call themselves of God want to spew of Satan, to pull you away from Jesus. You know, Hebrews 5 and 12, and I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to go to that real quick. Hebrews 5 and 12. And he said, for when the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. This is where we are. We got a whole lot of milk drinkers out there, including those that are supposed to be teaching Jesus. He said, when you ought to be teachers, you need to be retaught. You've got it all wrong. These people, these traditions of men are so pulling you away from Jesus and who he is, that the only Jesus you have is through your lips. He said, but their hearts are far from me. Amen. He said, but the strong meat is to them full age, meaning leaning on the Spirit of truth, the Holy Ghost, amen, to discern right and wrong. And who is that measure? Who's that measure of right and wrong today? It's the words of Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John 6, 63, 64, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. And he said in verse 64, but some of you won't believe it. And that's where many are today. You're not believing Jesus. You think Apostle Paul, you think Peter, and all these epistles that would rub up against what Jesus taught. And I go back again to Matthew being a clear cut showing for you. Matthew 20, 25, 26, Luke 22, 25, 26. And then you're going to sit there and say, obey them that have the rule over you. Your pastor is the under shepherd, or in many cases, they're trying to tell you today that he is the shepherd. When Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, and another they will not follow. But you're pulling them away from Jesus back to the priesthood of man, which is empty, zero. Jesus said, the words that I speak, not me, Jesus speaks, they are spirit and they are life. Colossians 2 and 8 says, beware or watch out. Be warned. See, not being led of the Spirit is why many do not know or teach Jesus. They've been persuaded by man to leave the teachings and the spirit of his teachings. For man's spoilings of philosophy, vain deceit. That's what he said in Colossians 2 and 8. Beware of man. Their spoiling of philosophy and vain deceit after the traditions of men, or heresies or dissensions of Christ, bitter dissensions of Christ. They don't want to do what Jesus said because they will not be kings. They will not be rulers. They will not be over you if they follow what Jesus said. They will be your servant. But that doesn't play in the modern church today. Oh, we got elders that's going to tell you what to do. You come to me. Oh, man, you got evangelists traveling around sucking up the pastors so they can keep going in their fake ministries in many cases. And I'm not saying there isn't anything good about it, but sinners do good too. Let me just tell you that. Doesn't mean they're from God. It's not their whole purpose, my point is. So let me tell you right now. I'll tell you all, if you heard anything from God, it's going to come through your pastor. You lying devil from hell. Take your dumb man tradition, stinky lying doctrine back to the hell where it came from, I tell you. Amen. That's your philosophy. That's your vain deceit. That's your traditions, the rudiments of this world. You know, these people are just like the hypocrites that Jesus called the scribes and Pharisees. Matthew 15, 1 through 9. I hope you go and read it. They're talking about all your disciples aren't washing your hands before you eat and they're breaking the traditions of men. We don't do that around here. Oh, we got to be proper and blah, blah, blah. What did Jesus say? Why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your traditions? And Jesus went on to talk about, you know, honoring your mother and father and how they just totally took that off the rail and brought it back to themselves. Read it. Mark 7 and 1 is the harmony scripture of that. You read these stories. Read the history. Read what Jesus was putting out. It's different than what the apostles are saying in many cases. Who are you going to choose? Once again, that's why I made this. Who are you going to choose? Is it Jesus or them? If there is a differing point, if there is a differing objective, you must go with Jesus. I don't care what you call yourself. Moses, Abraham, David, I don't care, all the patriarchs. If they weren't right and in tune with God in the last days here, the covenant, the new covenant of Jesus Christ, they're man. I'm not serving man. Neither should you be today. Amen. If that Holy Ghost is the same spirit going to take you out of here that took Jesus out of here, don't you think you should be in concert with it? Him? And it's going to glorify Jesus, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, the rest, the promise. Amen. The spirit of freedom and truth. Amen. The comfort of the fire, the witness of Jesus. Identifying with Christ is more than just being around him, around the church, around Christian music, listening to Christian music, even in prayer meetings where you are supposed to be consecrating your mind to the Lord, giving praise and listening for his spirit to instruct you in prayer, right? And just walking down the road, driving to the supermarket. Amen. Constantly aware. Being sober, that's what it means. In these last days, perhaps the cashier, I know there's not many left, but perhaps people that stock may have a word from God to you. Ministering spirits of angels, many caught unaware. God will speak to you however he wants. He'll throw a thought in your mind. Amen. It'll be good because every good and precious gift comes down from the Father of lights, amen, which is no shadow of turning and no variableness, amen. But you see, identifying with Christ is more than just, like I said, being around other people, listening to Christian music, prayer meetings, whatever. Identifying with Christ is knowing what he wants us to do, his word, and everything else outside of his word, albeit it might be the apostles that feel through the Holy Ghost that they're saying what they're saying. But if it doesn't jive, you're not back under man. And where you're reading that, oh, you got to obey them to have the rule over you. There's no one has the rule over you. Christ is the head of the man. Yes. You got to understand, if you believe one thing, you don't believe the other. I don't know how you do that. There's only one return point, and that is the golden standard of Jesus and what he was about. And he gave us that spirit, amen, that spirit of truth. He said he would lead and guide us into all truth and righteousness, amen. Being right, what is the gold standard of being right? Jesus, not Paul, not Peter, not any of them. Everybody in these churches today are putting the emphasis on the apostle. They even call themselves apostolic. You better get back to Jesus because the apostles wasn't always right. And it's pretty simple to validate that statement. And even if you're a Bible reader, you should have already had some scripture that validates what I just said. If not, reach out to me. I'll give you plenty. Amen. Peter was called by Jesus, even chosen by Jesus. However, when the rubber hit the road, when it counted, Peter denied having the same mission as Jesus. The big difference and the very reason for Matthew 7 and 23, Jesus will profess, declare, avow, he never knew you, if you do not have his mission and being led by his spirit beyond anyone else. You cannot have anyone else. You have to identify with Jesus. As great as the apostles, the things they did, we read about them, the attributes to Jesus, the credit they give to Jesus does not make them authority over Jesus. Does not make them authority over the Holy Ghost that Jesus gave you. If you do not have that live relationship with Jesus when he comes back, I'm afraid you're not going to make it. You're not going to go meet him in the air. Because that same spirit, not spirit of Paul, not spirit of Peter, not spirit of James, not spirit of John, none of them. You better have that spirit of Jesus. Man cannot save you. That spirit of the pastor. Oh, he's so kind, blah, blah, blah. Quit lifting man up. Many of you, there's presbyters, there's the bishop and so-and-so, and man, I see it all over. Oh, they're covering for us and our church and for all the region, and oh, my God, they're so great, and they do so much, and they just love God, and blah, blah, blah. Quit idling, man. Quit being an idolater. Because you're not going to make it to heaven that way. Oh, but you got to give honor to whom honors. When did Jesus say that? Did not Jesus say that if you lift yourself up, he's going to bring you down? So I'm pretty sure that wasn't the spirit of Jesus to go around lifting people up. Oh, Peter, you done such a good job. I never read any. Was it left out? I don't know. But what I got is what I got to go with. So here we are. Matthew 7 and 23. Jesus will profess. He will declare. He will avow. He never knew you. If you do not identify with him. Peter don't count, Paul don't count, James, John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, any of the writers in the New Testament, Old Testament, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all of them. Nobody counts but Jesus. If you're going to identify with anyone, if you're going to lift up anyone, it better be Jesus or you're not going to be with him. That's a fact. You see, Jesus basically said, I never knew you. He said, we're not on the same page. You're not on my mission. You're not doing what I told you to do. You went out here and you built a man's building and a church and all this stuff. I didn't tell you to do all that. You're lifting up man. You're having all these things and you're putting all that money there when I'm watching my people that I want to save hungry. They're thirst. And yet what you're doing, you've built little coffee shops that they can't even afford to come to. You're building structures. You're building things that are not where the people that I'm calling will be coming. And that's why I don't know you. You're not with me. You're not teaching. You're not acting. You're not doing anything that I said. You're doing a lot of quotation of my words. That's why you think you know me. But your actions, your teachings, your associations, your lack of love for truth, your doings were never a representative or representations of who I am. I hope that the Lord has reached someone today. I pray that this message is going to reach your ears, not just your ears, but it's going to get into your heart. And you're going to want to know Jesus. You're going to want to say, you know, gosh, man, I've been doing all these things and I thought they was for the Lord. But when I look at Jesus and the simplicity of preaching the gospel and letting people know the love of Jesus, when I look at that, it's not any of this. And we read it, Hebrews 5 and 12. You're teachers and you ought to be taught again. You don't even have the right purpose. Many will come in my name and deceive many. Many. Do you identify with Jesus Christ today? Are you reading those gospels and are you applying what Jesus said? And by that same spirit, are you understanding your mission in Christ? Most of our missions is not to go on a mission. It's just to live in Christ. It's just to teach our children to live what the word says. And God will bring people in your path. You will be able to let them know the goodness of Jesus Christ and how they can find him. That is the gospel of peace. That is your commission. Beyond that, God will make provisions. He will do things. He will put you in a situation. You say, God, my life is yours. Whatever you need me to do, whatever you want me to do, whether that job ends for you, you have to move away to Tennessee or some other place, he's got someone waiting. You do not have to force anything. It is not our obligation to force anything. We live for Jesus. We are ready to promote the gospel. We are ready to tell people who Jesus is and the love and the testimony of our faith. That is our obligation. Amen. He said, what can you, the Lord feeds the sparrow, the birds. He clothes the grass, the lilies. Amen. He said, can you, by taking one thought, add one bit or stature to your height? No. I hope some people are getting this. I hope some folks are listening, and I hope that you're going to serve God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength. He's going to be number one. Not some false mission pastor driven. And again, what I'm telling you today, and I started off with this, that I'm not saying everything that is in your life, around your life, is wrong. I'm not saying all the scriptures that are wrong. If it's not adding up with Jesus, it's in there. But it's for us to understand not to do it, or understand that others are doing it. Doesn't mean you're to do it. Rightly dividing the word of truth, and you can only do that through the Holy Ghost that will lead and guide you to all truth. Amen. And bring to remembrance, Jesus said, whatsoever I have said unto you. He did not give that away. Whose word are going to judge you in the last day? Did he say, the apostles, the Paul? He said the foundations were built on the prophets, the apostles. But who's the chief? Who is the chief cornerstone? Who is the head of it all? So if they veer off of anything that Jesus said, or how he meant it, or by the spirit in which he brought it, you better not be listening to it. And I don't care who they are. It doesn't matter. He is number one. And if he's not, he's nothing to you. Amen. God bless you. And I appreciate once again that you're watching and sharing this with us. Your associations, your lack of love for truth, your doings were never a representative or representations of who I am. I hope that the Lord has reached someone today. I pray that this message is going to reach your ears, not just your ears, but it's going to get into your heart. And you're going to want to know Jesus. You're going to want to say, gosh, man, I, I've been doing all these things, and I thought they was for the Lord. But when I look at Jesus and the simplicity of preaching the gospel and letting people know the love of Jesus, when I look at that, it's not any of this. And we read it, Hebrews 5 and 12. You're teachers and you ought to be taught again. You don't even have the right purpose. Many will come in my name and deceive many. Many. Do you identify with Jesus Christ today? Are you reading those gospels and are you applying what Jesus said? And by that same spirit, are you understanding your mission in Christ? Most of our missions is not to go on a mission. It's just to live in Christ. It's just to teach our children to live what the Word says. And God will bring people in your path. You will be able to let them know the goodness of Jesus Christ and how they can find Him. That is the gospel of peace. That is your commission. Beyond that, God will make provisions. He will do things. He will put you in a situation. You say, God, my life is yours. Whatever you need me to do, whatever you want me to do, whether that job ends for you, you have to move away to Tennessee or some other place, He's got someone waiting. You do not have to force anything. It is not our obligation to force anything. We live for Jesus. We are ready to promote the gospel. We are ready to tell people who Jesus is and the love and the testimony of our faith. That is our obligation. Amen. He said, what? Can you? The Lord feeds the sparrow, the birds. He clothes the grass, the lilies. Amen. He said, can you, by taking one thought, add one bit or stature to your height? No. I hope some people are getting this. I hope some folks are listening, and I hope that you're going to serve God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength. He's going to be number one. Not some false mission pastor driven. And again, what I'm telling you today, and I started off with this, that I'm not saying everything that is in your life, around your life, is wrong. I'm not saying all the scriptures that are wrong. If it's not adding up with Jesus, it's in there. But it's for us to understand. Not to do it. Or understand that others are doing it. Doesn't mean you're to do it. Rightly dividing the word of truth, and you can only do that through the Holy Ghost that will lead and guide you to all truth. Amen. And bring to remembrance, Jesus said, whatsoever I have said unto you. He did not give that away. Whose word are going to judge you in the last day? Did he say, oh, the apostles, the Paul? He said the foundations were built on the prophets, the apostles. But who's the chief? Who is the chief cornerstone? Who is the head of it all? So if they veer off of anything that Jesus said or how he meant it or by the spirit in which he brought it, you better not be listening to it. And I don't care who they are. It doesn't matter. He is number one. And if he's not, he's nothing to you. Amen. God bless you. And I appreciate once again that you're watching and sharing this with us. Go in peace, my friend, in Jesus' name.